All right. So as Paul has been discussing the importance of recognizing that God has the right to choose whom he will, to bring about his will, in that context of the Jewish mind, he's been making this case to apply it to the Jew who believes that he has some sort of a inborn advantage being a Jew now under Christ. Because the mindset that the Jews had was such that because they have been the people of God all along, therefore God treats them differently. And so they saw themselves in a certain light. They saw the Gentiles as being lesser or less important than they were. And so as Paul has gone through here in chapter 9, he's based this upon, first of all, the mindset that prevents Israel from fully coming to Christ as they should. And this applies both to the Jews at large as a nation, but also to the Jewish Christians, because that's the very situation that's being dealt with regarding the attitude that the Jews have in Rome among the Christians. And so as he has brought out different examples, such as, you know, children of Abraham, well, there's Ishmael as well as Isaac, and then you've got the sons of Isaac, you've got Jacob, but you also have Esau. And all the way through, God has chosen those whom he will use to bring about his will. That doesn't make them better than anyone else. And it certainly doesn't suggest that those who weren't chosen to bring about ultimately the genealogy of Jesus, that doesn't mean that they weren't able to please God. It doesn't mean that they weren't able to obey. And so as he's gotten to verse 30, Paul makes the statement, "What shall we say then? That Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness have attained to righteousness, even the righteousness of faith." He's quoted from three different places in the Old Testament, both in Hosea and then two in Isaiah, that describe how that the Gentiles were meant to be brought in and how that Israel was to be rejected as a people from the perspective that they weren't obeying, but because God would save a remnant, there were those of Israel who would follow him and do as he told them to do, but that did not apply to all of Israel. That's why earlier when he quoted from Isaiah, "Though the number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, the remnant shall be saved." Only those who are truly serving the way they should shall be saved. Those are the ones that God identifies as being part of his people. That doesn't apply to all of Israel. And so when he quotes from Isaiah, he recognizes that because of Israel's lack of proper service to God, they should have been destroyed if it weren't for the Lord and for his promise to Abraham. So, the Gentiles then, who did not pursue righteousness, he's not saying that they haven't, as Gentiles become Christians, that they aren't changing their lives to conform to what God has told them. Now, that's not the point that he's making. In fact, it goes back to the Jewish mindset and the Gentile mindset. The Jews, they have been pursuing righteousness, albeit not properly, they have been pursuing righteousness through the law. The Gentiles didn't have the law available to them. Therefore, from that perspective, they weren't pursuing righteousness. They didn't have the oracles of God. It is to that which Paul speaks about the Jews having that one advantage, that they were given the oracles of God. They were given the prophecies. They should have known. Of course, they chose to ignore many of the signs that were written. But in verse 31, "But Israel, pursuing the law of righteousness, has not attained to the law of righteousness." You have two different phrases here. You have the righteousness of faith, and then you have the law of righteousness. And then to which Paul would go on to say in verse 32, why? Because they did not seek it by faith, but as it were by the works of the law. Was there anything wrong under the old law, before Christ established the new law, was there anything wrong with obeying the old law? I mean, that's what they were supposed to do, right? That's what they were commanded to do. Was there anything wrong with offering the sacrifices the way God commanded them to do? No. But what had the Jews turned the law, or how had they seen the law? What had it become to them? Doug?
Instead of the righteousness of God, it was their righteousness, their way of thinking, what they had evolved it around, like, you know, not taking care of the parents, giving the money to the church.
Right. And that application of taking God's law of righteousness, okay, that's how they viewed it. It was their means by which they made themselves righteous. Okay? You have one Jew who would obey the law, but thought himself righteous because he was willing to do this. I pay tithes of all that I possess. I fast, you know, 3 times a week and so forth. That made him righteous. Whereas you have another Jew who doesn't consider his own righteousness, but rather simply obeys in faith. The one who obeys the old law in faith, even, you know, under the old law before Christ came, the one who obeyed the old law in faith, who did all the same works as this other, who offered all the same sacrifices, between the two, which one's justified by God? Yeah, the one who is willing to work by faith. Okay, and that's what Paul, we discussed this back in chapter 3 and chapter 4 when we talked about the works of law and how important it is to identify for our friends and neighbors especially. Because Romans, really chapter 3, chapter 4, chapter 5, those phrases regarding works of law get applied to us today. When we define baptism as being an essential means of salvation for the removing of our sins, well, that's a work of law. Well, it is from the perspective that God commanded it, and therefore we must obey it. But from the perspective that Paul uses the phrase works of law as it pertained to the Jews, these are the commandments of God that I as a Jew obeyed in order to make myself righteous. Because I did these works, I am therefore owed righteousness. I earned my righteousness. That makes me holy. When in fact, God simply commanded it. And therefore, like with Abraham, that's why Abraham's such an important point to bring up from Romans chapter 4, is that Abraham, did he still obey God's commandments? But he believed God and obeyed him, and who accounted it to him for righteousness? God did. It is, I have no right or authority to account myself righteous, but rather it is God who justifies. It is God who accounts unto righteousness. And so when Paul describes the Gentiles, when he says they have attained to righteousness, even the righteousness of faith, he's not describing all of the Gentiles at large. They haven't been saved automatically. Those Gentiles who have chosen to come to Christ, who have become Christians, that is, they've attained to righteousness through what? Through faith. Okay, through faith. Whereas Israel, and not blanketly speaking, there have obviously Paul is even one of them who was a Jew who came to Christ, but he's still speaking from the mindset that even some of the Jewish Christians still had. Okay, they still had this thought process of self-righteousness. And so when Paul describes in verse 31, Israel pursuing the law of righteousness has not attained. Why did they not attain to the law of righteousness? I mean, beyond even the mindset. Okay, obviously they were using the law as a means of their own righteousness. But even beyond that, to the very definition of law, why could they not attain to the righteousness of law? They couldn't keep it perfectly. Okay, that is the very definition of law. Law defines what is right and what is wrong. And so the moment I err in one part of the law, am I guilty of it all? Okay, James teaches that regarding the new law in Christ Jesus. That is still an important principle that is established, that if we break one commandment, we're guilty of all. Therefore, something else has to come in, and that's where Christ comes in to allow us the forgiveness of sins. But Israel sought righteousness and holiness and justification through the law only. That's how they viewed it. And of course, the sacrifices, they didn't come in beside the old law. They were in fact incorporated into the law. And besides that, Hebrews chapter 10 tells us the blood of bulls and goats could never take away sin. So verse 32, why? Because they did not seek it by faith, but as it were by the works of the law. For they stumbled at that stumbling stone. Okay, so on the one hand, you've got the law itself. They didn't keep it perfectly. And in order to be justified by law, you have to keep it perfectly. Then you throw in the mindset as well that they kind of took that part out of their mindset of keeping it perfectly and in fact used elements of the law that they wanted to, ultimately, to consider themselves righteous. That's why he says, because they did not seek it by faith. There were Jews who were justified under the old law because they sought it and obeyed it through faith. Okay, they obeyed God knowing full well the law did not make them holy, did not make them righteous, but because God commanded it, they obeyed. Therefore, they were justified. However, for the nation of the Jews as a whole, that wasn't the case. They sought it as works of the law by the means of making themselves righteous. Go ahead, Lisa. Right.
And the second group made it about God.
Right. Yeah. And I think that's a kind of a boiling down. The whole point is that for the Gentiles, and again, this is not a blanket statement. There were Jews who did obey God properly. Paul, you know, he sought to obey God in everything that he did. And obviously that's why he came to Christ. But he's speaking from a general, this is Israel's mindset. This is the way they've conducted themselves under the law. And now, even now that the law of Christ has been instituted, even for these Jewish Christians, there is still that mindset of, I'm righteous because of what I've done, as opposed to these nasty Gentiles. Okay, that mindset still existed. And so, verse 32, for they stumbled at that stumbling stone, verse 33, as it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and rock of offense. Whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. So as Paul quotes, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone, who or what is the stumbling stone? Yeah. Yeah, that Peter even quotes the same passage in identifying Jesus as the stumbling stone. Specifically, he says, I lay in Zion. What was Zion? Jerusalem. Yeah, the Temple Mount, Jerusalem. So in Zion, in Jerusalem, God put down a stumbling stone and rock of offense. Why? Why was Jesus the rock of offense? And notice that specifically how it's pertaining to the Jews and the Gentiles and righteousness. How does verse 33 fit into that paradigm that he's established? What is it specifically that Jesus has brought about that is a stumbling stone and a rock of offense for the Jews? Yes, ma'am.
Part of it was that it wasn't a physical kingdom.
Okay.
And he overcame death. He everything was like counterintuitive to what they expected. They
right.
They had a physical king, he is a spiritual king.
Right.
They expected him to be a man of preeminence, and he was a humble man that served other people and ate with sinners.
Right.
So his whole life, his whole existence, and especially his death, was a stumbling block. Because that's not what they had envisioned or thought.
Okay, so he was contrary to everything that they expected for their warrior Messiah. All right, that's one part of it. Yes, ma'am?
Partially too, because he was going to not just say, you know, the Jewish people, those who obeyed, but Gentiles as well. That was a huge thing for them to overcome, that they're not chosen, per se.
Right, right. So you've got, yeah, I think that's a part of it as well. You've got the concept that all the Gentiles would be able to come to him without having to go through Moses, without having to be circumcised, without needing a Jew next to them to be saved. The Gentiles could be saved just as equally and independently as a Jew could. But then you include into that, and all of that was just said, is all part of Jesus being a stumbling block for the Jews. But notice how all this is to what end? What does he say in verse 31? To what end? Righteousness. Okay, righteousness. That's what end the Jews thought they were seeking and thought that they were appealing to, and yet at the same time they weren't, because they were taking it upon themselves to do that. So the institution of the law of Christ Jesus and Jesus as Messiah, all the things that he brought, okay, including the fact that the Gentiles could be saved, all of that's wrapped up in the means by which I am made righteous. Okay? Whereas the Jews saw the law and the law only as the means by which they made themselves righteous, Christ brought in the recognition. And it wasn't something new. By no means was this new. The just shall live by what? That was incorporated in the old law, and as the Hebrew writer establishes in Hebrews chapter 11, this was incorporated in the patriarchal law. Okay, faith was an essential component since the world began. Since man was given the law of God in the Garden of Eden, man was required to obey in faith. Has always been so. Never was man ever justified of his own works. It was always God justifying those whom obeyed in faith. Jesus simply brought it, and as verse 33 points out, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and rock of offense, whoever believes on him, not whoever obeys the law. That doesn't mean that the law is not important. The law is, we have to obey the law. Whoever believes on him, if I believe him and I love him, what will I do? I'll keep his commandments. Okay, the law is by no means taken away in this from this point, but the fact that whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. Belief, faith, is a key element to this. Of course, we know that faith without works is what? Dead. Okay, so belief incorporates the understanding that because I believe, I will therefore obey. That's what faith is. All right, Doug, I saw your hand a little while ago.
Not to say the Gentiles didn't have issues to overcome, just like the Jews.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But mm-hmm. It was completely different. And you kind of wonder which was the worst.
Yeah.
As far as harder to self-examine
right.
yourself and realize, I've been coming to church every day. How can I be wrong?
Right.
Type thing. And, you know, an issue that us, maybe grew up in the church versus someone who didn't have, you know, couldn't get that same mindset.
Right.
I've been here all my life, you know, type thing. Could go there real easy.
We face that today. I mean, there are those who have no background in Christ. In some ways, it's an uphill battle to talk about God, to talk about salvation, just what we consider basic principles. But there's no already ingrained points that have to be unlearned and then retaught with regard to what God says, as opposed to what somebody may have been incorporated from birth to believe that man has taught. And so there's, it's six of one and half a dozen of the other type of thing. It's not that the Jews, and again, that's why the context of this is specifically addressing, again, this goes back to the application for the Jewish Christians. Paul's not writing about Israel at large for the sake of writing to Israel. Okay, Israel's not going to read his words. It's not going to make any difference. He's writing this to the saints in Rome. And certainly this is going to apply to the Gentile Christians too, especially when we get to chapter 11. That's where specific application for the Gentiles comes in. But this is for the Jewish Christians to recognize and understand the background. But Paul has really laid the foundation for them to understand, this is where all this started. This is why you think the way you do, and here's also why you shouldn't. Yes, ma'am.
Versus today, talking to so many people who are not concerned with obedience, but, you know, just believing God.
Right.
And, you know, one was based on works, obedience, and then one is based off of just faith.
Right.
You know, and it takes the perfect marriage of the two.
Right, right, exactly. And that's, you know, where we talk to people about what they call faith only, which is just belief only. That application of, well, does that mean we shouldn't obey God? It has to be one or the other. You can't, if they in any way insinuate, well, yeah, we obey some of it. No, you have to either take it all or not at all. Okay, you can't just say, well, yeah, we should obey some of it, but not all of it's necessary to follow or obey, or you can pick and choose what you want. Now, either it's belief only, which is not substantiated in the Bible at all, or it's belief, and therefore I'm willing to follow everything God tells me to do. And ultimately, any argument to, oh, well, baptism, you're just trying to earn your salvation, that's a cop-out. It's just trying to suggest that I don't have to do anything to be saved. I'm happy with where I am and what I'm doing, with just thinking that as long as I believe, I'm okay. And that's not at all what the Scriptures teach. All right, anything else through verse 33? Anything else through Romans chapter 9? Okay, let's go to our questions. Question 1, why is Paul in so much pain regarding his brethren in the flesh? What does he say that shows this? This goes back to really verses 1 and 2, mainly of chapter 9. Sorry? Why is Paul in so much pain about Israel? Yeah, they're not in a saved state. And that's one of the key elements. And that's what Romans 9 and 10, it kind of lays the foundation when he says, my conscience bears me witness. I have a great sorrow and continual grief in my heart. That's where his thought process is with regard to Israel as a nation. These are his people. He doesn't want to see them rejected by Christ. And yet, this isn't on Christ's end. This is on Israel's end. They refuse to submit, as he's going to get to in chapter 10, to the righteousness that is in Christ Jesus. And so this feeling, this thought process that Paul has, it has to do with the fact that they are not saved. But it's not just their lack of salvation or being in a saved state. It's all the stumbling blocks, really, that they've placed there themselves, ultimately, that is kind of embodied in Christ Jesus, encapsulated by Jesus. But it's all the obstacles that are preventing them from being saved. Okay, it starts with the mindset that Israel has, and then chapter 10, he's going to build on that mindset and the different elements that have to come into play before you even get to the concept of baptism. You know, Romans 10, a lot of times, and that's what Romans 10 is going to be a very important chapter for us to cover, because Romans 10 is one of those passages we see quoted or referenced a lot. Romans 10, 13, call on the name of the Lord, you shall be saved. That gets used a lot, all the time. And if you try to talk to somebody about Romans 10, well, the argument is, oh, well, Paul didn't say anything about baptism. Well, you're right, he doesn't. Because before you can even begin to start talking about baptism, you have to start talking about the basic belief in Christ Jesus and the necessity for forgiveness of sins. Israel didn't have the thought process that they needed that. The blood of bulls and goats take care of my sins. And so this all is building to this point where he's going to get to at the end of Romans chapter 10. Has the gospel not been taught? Absolutely it has. They've had the opportunity, but they refuse to accept it. That's why Israel isn't saved. That's why Paul has such sorrow and grief in his heart. It has nothing to do on God's end. God's made it available to the Jew and Gentile alike. It's because the Jews, again, generally speaking, not some Jews were Christians, but generally speaking, the Jews simply would not accept Christ and him crucified because of what it meant for their history, their law. All right? So why is Paul in so much pain? Because Israel's not saved. What does he say to show this? Well, he puts it in verse 3 to a certain point that kind of shows the depth of his sorrow. What does he say?
He sacrificed himself.
Yeah, I could wish that I could put myself. Yeah. That I could be sacrificed for them so that they might be saved. Of course, Paul's not meaning this literally from the perspective that he's willing to sacrifice his own soul and go to hell if that meant that Israel could go to heaven. Okay, because one of the things that we're taught throughout the New Testament is that there's nothing more important than our soul. Okay, that the one area where we must be selfish is with regard to protecting our soul, making sure we're serving God the way we should. So Paul's not saying that, well, if God would let me, I'd sacrifice my soul for theirs. What Paul's point is that I could wish that I could. There's a part of me that wishes I could give myself if it meant that all of Israel could be saved instead. Of course, that's not how it works, and Paul knows that. Okay, I mean, Jesus died for the whole world, didn't he? But does that mean the whole world is therefore saved? No. No. Okay, and certainly if the death of Christ didn't accomplish automatic salvation for all mankind, Paul giving his own soul isn't going to accomplish that for Israel. Paul knows that. It's describing the depth of his sorrow for Israel. Anything else through question 1?
Well,
And we're going to see this again in chapter 10 in the first two or three verses. He's going to show what his prayer is. Okay, and I don't doubt that his constant prayer was that more and more of the children of Israel would come to Christ. He makes that statement that this is my prayer. Anything else to question one? Question two. What point is Paul making in verses 1 through 5 that would cause a Jew to think that God's word had come to naught or been made no effect, verse 6? Because that's part of what Paul, when he describes this in verse 6, he says, but it is not that the word of God has taken no effect, for they are not all Israel who are of Israel. So what is it that Paul says here in these first five verses that suggests or that might lead these Jewish Christians to think, well, does that mean that God's word has been made invalid? Yeah, right. So if there's no benefit for Israel, then doesn't that put God's word, doesn't that make, as he says here in verse 6, doesn't that make it no effect? Especially going back to what specific word from God? This doesn't just refer to the law. It goes back to whom? Abraham. Okay, Abraham. And that's why Paul builds on that concept of the seed of Abraham. Because when he says, who are Israelites, verse 4, to whom pertain the adoption, the glory, the covenants, giving of the law, service of God, and the promises, you read that, you look at that, and you think, oh, well, that means the Jews, they almost are kind of grandfathered into salvation, aren't they? Okay, verse 5, of whom are the fathers, and from whom, according to the flesh, Christ came, who is over all and eternally blessed. But what he's saying in verse 6, not that the word of God has taken no effect. This isn't about the fact that Israel, God didn't, and that's what kind of leads to the rest of it, is that God used Israel to bring about the Messiah. That does not mean that they have some kind of grandfathered in clause to salvation. And so that's all of this is based on verse 3. You know, I could wish I myself were accursed from Christ, from my brethren, my countrymen, according to the flesh. That suggestion that they are not saved, that they are not in a righteous state before God right now, that leads to verse 6 and 7. It's not about the flesh. The seed of Abraham that was prophesied has nothing to do with in the flesh, because after all, Ishmael was a seed of Abraham, but that doesn't, you know, and even the Jews would accept that, would not, they would reject the idea that Ishmael was the seed of Abraham. Absolutely no. And they would say the same thing about Esau. Oh no, Esau's not the seed of Abraham. Well, it goes back to who did God use to bring about his will? And so that's why Paul describes this here in when we talk about question two, what point is Paul making, verses 1 through 5? It's that because of their history, because of their background, they had this sense of being grandfathered in. That's what they thought they were. And so because of the promise to Abraham, Paul, you're saying we're lost. That means that God's word has been made to no effect. It hasn't had the appropriate outcome or result that should have come. But Paul says that's not the case at all. That wasn't the end result or conclusion Israel was supposed to draw to begin with. That just because through them came the promise, or through Abraham came the promise of the Messiah, and therefore because they were of the lineage of Abraham, that somehow that made them special. I mean, you think about what John the Baptist taught the Jews. What did he teach? Do you remember? Pointed to some rocks. What did he say? We have Abraham as our father.
God can raise up children
to
Abraham from these stones.
Yeah. It's just the flesh. Okay. And John the Baptist, even at that point, was implying that being children of Abraham or the seed of Abraham in the flesh is nothing. That is not at all what God is speaking to with regard to the seed of Abraham. Anything else to question two? Yes, sir.
Joe made an interesting point earlier about these are God's chosen people, and that's what they counted on. They would say, yeah, God chose us. He didn't choose the descendants of Ishmael. God chose us over the descendants of Esau. So we're it.
Right.
And as your illustration from John the Baptist, if God really needs children of Abraham to fulfill his promise, he can get them anywhere, even for
rock.
Right.
The Jews didn't have any problem with God choosing as long as he chose them.
Right.
But when he chose a different way to be a child of Abraham and inherit the promises, faith over law, they didn't like that choice of God's. So that's their objection.
They didn't like that choice or the fact that the Gentile could be equal to them. From that, they can equally be a child of Abraham, you know, through the spirit instead of the flesh. Yeah, absolutely. Anything else to question too?
They had so much prejudice to overcome.
Yeah, they did.
Because it seemed like it was just built on from year to year, generation.
Generation after generation. Yeah.
And I mean, that's why it was the perfect time for Jesus to come.
Right. Yeah, the prejudice that is built in the minds of the Jews, and again, this speaks to their identity. In some ways, their identity, how they saw themselves was as much on who and what they rejected as it was on who and what they accepted. Okay, I mean, they identified themselves as much as being not Gentiles as they were, we are Jews. Okay, and that, when you start, just like, you know, Jesus, when he died, that wall of separation between Jew and Gentile was taken down. All right, and that's what Paul describes in Ephesians chapter 2 about in one body, then Christ is able to deliver both Jew and Gentile together in one body, in one spirit. Well, the Jew, that just completely blew up their identity as a nation and as individuals. And of course, when Paul describes in Philippians chapter 3 all the lifestyle and the things he turned his back on, that he counted as rubbish for the sake of Christ, for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, this is part of that. It helps us to appreciate everything Paul and all the other Jews that turned to Christ, what they were willing to put aside in order to come to Christ and accept what Jesus teaches. Okay, I mean, there's a lot there. More so, perhaps, than we can fully appreciate simply because of the social aspect of it regarding the people of the Jews, their identity, and how all that worked together. Very close-knit group of people that we can't really liken to today from a social perspective.
It was their government. It was their religion.
It was everything they were.
It was their race.
Yeah.
Their persona.
Yeah, that's why the Hebrew writer, when he speaks regarding the coming of the destruction of Jerusalem, he kind of implies that several times when he refers to that day, okay, as we see the day approaching, that destruction of Jerusalem would ultimately bring an end to that identity of Israel as Israel. Okay, not only would the records be destroyed, the genealogies, the temple would be destroyed, Jerusalem, the city of David, the city of God, would be destroyed. For the Jews, that was, for all intents and purposes, that was the end of their existence as a nation. Okay, and that's why when the Hebrew writer refers to in chapter 6 how that these things are coming to an end, okay, they will soon pass away. It's not that the old law hadn't been done away with when Christ, you know, died and was resurrected and ascended to heaven. It was, but the application of their identity as a nation still existed. And that's why the Hebrew writer refers to the fact these things will soon pass away. Because only in about 5 years, remember the Hebrew letter was written around 65 AD, 5 years from that point, the Jerusalem would be gone. And so that identity would go with it. Anything else to question too?
Kind of wonder if that changed them when that.
Yeah.
Did
that help in any way?
The possibility of change.
Yeah. Yeah. It kind of makes you wonder if many of the Jews who for decades may have rejected the teaching of the Christians and of Christ after the temple was destroyed, maybe it helped them to overcome that stumbling block they created for themselves. Remember, we talked from Acts chapter 7 how that the temple in many ways kind of became an idol to itself for the Jews. This is where our God is. This is how they identified themselves. And so, to a certain extent, if that temple, that city of Jerusalem is gone or is no longer what it was, for sure, maybe that might have helped a lot of the Jews to overcome that and truly embrace what Christ taught. I mean, Christ himself, did he warn about Jerusalem being destroyed? Yeah. And I wonder how many Jewish Christians warn their families. You know, it's coming. One day, this is going to all be gone. What are you going to have left? It kind of provides an interesting parallel to 1 Corinthians 13. You put all your stock, all your faith, all your pride in your gifts, your miraculous gifts. Paul says, if you don't have love, what are you going to do when it's all gone? It's kind of the same for the Jews. You put all your stock in your fleshly genealogy as a Jew, identity to God in flesh. What are you going to do when that's gone? You got nothing left. And there's applications about that today too, isn't there? Applications for that today too. Anything else to question two? All right, question three. What two points does Paul make to prove it is children of promise that are reckoned for a seed, not children according to the flesh? And how does this directly fit with question two? There are two main examples, points that he makes to show that the children of promise are reckoned for a seed, not children according to the flesh.
Ishmael and Esau.
Esau. Yeah, Ishmael, son of Abraham, he wasn't according to the promise, yet he's still seed of Abraham. So if we're talking about physical seed, Ishmael should be just as valid as Isaac was. And then for that matter, when it comes to Jacob and Esau, Esau's just as much a child of Isaac and grandchild of Abraham as Jacob, but yet Jacob was chosen instead. And so it just from looking at it from the promise according to the flesh doesn't make sense. They knew what the genealogies were. It doesn't make sense. So that's why it goes back to this, to the promise. That's where the Gentiles kind of come into it. Seed according to the promise and not of the flesh. Yeah. And then that fits with question two, because this is part of the whole background of Israel looking at themselves according to the flesh. And that's why, you know, the Jew would say, oh, but this is all about us. I mean, the Old Testament's all about us. The prophecies, everything, it's us. They saw themselves as the fulfillment of the promise to Abraham, didn't they? We are the seed of Abraham. Okay, they saw themselves as the fulfillment of that promise. And so that's why Paul makes the case verses 6 on through verse 10. And well, really, I mean, he's been making the case off and on throughout all of Romans. But he makes that case that, listen, you're confusing God's plan of bringing about the fulfillment of the promise with God's salvation. And that's what they did. They confused the two. Okay, God brought about his plan of the promise, which is the fulfillment of the promise, which is Christ Jesus. He brought that about through you. But they were imposing their own thought process of salvation as a result of that. And that's why Paul says God can do what he wants. That doesn't dictate salvation for anybody. It's just he chose what to do with whom. He has mercy on whom he has mercy. Anything through question three? I mean, how wonderful is that example from Paul of Ishmael and Esau? I mean, that's as point blank as it can get, isn't it? You can't get any better than Ishmael and Esau as an example of how can you claim to be of the promise according to the flesh. It doesn't fit. Question four, how does Paul use Jacob and Esau to manifest that God's plan is founded upon his election and not of works?
The choice of Jacob over Esau was made before they even were born to do any good or evil.
Okay, God chose Jacob. In fact, Paul specifically says, not because of any good or evil they had done. Okay, I mean, before they were even born, God chose Jacob. It had nothing to do with their works, of Jacob having earned it over Esau, okay, of God choosing, oh, I just don't want to like Esau, so I'm going to choose Jacob instead, even before they were born. Paul says no. He chose Jacob because that's the way his plan came about. That's how he had set up his plan. That's why it says, or that's why Paul says he refers to the election of grace. Okay, God chose to use him But that has nothing to do about with salvation. And that's where, going back to here in verse 11, for the children not yet being born, nor having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him who calls. That's where, especially verse 11, fits into the mindset of predestination. Okay, that one part, that people want to apply that and take that to salvation. When God choosing Jacob had nothing to do with Esau being rejected for salvation. It had to do with God using his plan. That's it. And to imply or infer salvation there, verse 11, is to take out the very point that Paul's trying to make. In fact, the very point that Paul's trying to make is you can't just assume you're saved because of your state, because of being as Jews. Okay, you have to fully accept and obey, and that's that whole concept of choosing to come to Christ defeats the idea of assuming predestination there in verse 11. All right, so that's how Paul uses Jacob and Esau to show that God's plan is founded upon he elected Jacob. That's not a condemnation of Esau. Anything else to question for? Question 5. Paul uses Jacob and Esau to show that individuals have already been elected by God to be saved and lost. True or false? False. Paul uses Jacob and Esau to show that individuals can be used to bring about his will. Right? But God choosing or not choosing me to bring about his will, and of course it's different than it would be today, because at that point God was specifically bringing about his son. Okay, that's what the whole point of the plan of salvation being brought through. But if I'm in the Old Testament, okay, I'm the brother of Jacob, all right, God chose Jacob and didn't choose me, did that mean that God didn't like me or that I couldn't be saved? No. No. So question 4 and question 5 kind of, both those answers go together. Anything else to question 5? Question 6. Why would a Jew argue that there was unrighteousness with God? What is Paul's answer to this, and how does Pharaoh fit into this? So when Paul describes kind of the hypothetical argument, well, there's unrighteousness with God after he talks about Jacob and Esau, verse 14, what shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? Why would the Jew make that argument? But Paul says, is there unrighteousness with God? Certainly not. Was it unrighteous for God to arbitrarily choose Jacob as opposed to Esau? Was that wrong for God to do that? And that's the very point that Paul brings out from verse 15. God did the same thing with Pharaoh. God chooses, I'll show mercy on whom I have mercy, and whom I harden, I'll harden. That has nothing to do with their choosing. It has everything to do with me, who I'm going to use to bring about my will. God can still allow for the free will of man, and knowing that what those choices are going to be, God still bring his will about. That has nothing to do with forcing them into anything. All right, we'll stop there. We will pick up and finish our questions, question 6 and finish chapter 9 next week. Romans chapter 10 notes are on the table, as well as a stapled Acts chapter 9 as well, so you don't have to pick up two pieces of paper. It's all in one now. Thank you, everybody, for the thoughts and comments.